All right, well, welcome back, everyone, to episode 29 of the Rally Report podcast. We have an immensely talented individual, both on and off the court, joining us today. She's the top player from Scotland, ranked 29 in the world. She's also taken the world of commentating. She's taken over, and I'd say she's one of the most badass players on tour, who's immensely fashionable, despite some people begging to differ, as we found out on Instagram. But yeah, welcome, Lisa Aitken. How are you?
Thank you for having me, Sean. Looking forward to the naming and the shaming of the dissing fashion, although I think you and I have coordinated well with our funky shirts today.
Oh, yeah. Bringing the A game for it. But yeah, I will call out some of the people who have commented on your fashion. I think there are a couple PSA players, I think, who voted on that. But to kick things off, could you give us a quick update on what's been happening on your end of things as of late from social media? And, you know, we spoke yesterday about how I called it the absolute bender and also the series of unfortunate events. But not to start off the pod on downer, but why don't you give us a little scoop?
Yeah, sure. Well, it's the end of the season. Once every 4 years, we have this thing called the Commonwealth Games. So even though it's the end of the season, mentally, it's not really. In a couple of weeks time, we're heading to Birmingham for the Commonwealth Games. So that's really exciting. We got the singles, we got the doubles, women's and mixed for myself. So it's really cool. We get to play doubles once every 4 years. And it's a game that I absolutely love. I have so much fun on the doubles court. I really enjoy having a partner on there with me, a little team. But yeah, the season's finished. It was, I guess, on paper, one of the better seasons I've had, with getting to 29 in the world, being my highest world ranking. It was before that, before the end of the season, we had the World Tour Finals in Cairo, where I commentated. And then that led into the absolute bender that you referred to, which I can assure you now was definitely not an absolute bender for me. I'd played a tournament in Mauritius a couple of weeks prior to this, and I unfortunately had to pull out because I got norovirus. Norovirus then led to E. coli. Naturally, E. coli led to some funky antibiotics that I got in Cairo when I was doing the commentating. So Mykonos was where the bender was, and it was just me completely sidelined, not able to really eat or drink anything. Watching the girls have a great time. No, in all seriousness, I had a good time. It was great to kind of take these girls who are, they're a fantastic group of girls, they're great fun, and take them out of that squash setting and put them into something where they can just let loose, just completely relax, and let's see that side of them. You know, we're not competing against one another, we've no tournament coming up in the immediate, and it had been tough. It had been a tough 2 years. If you think about, like, coming back since COVID, we've kind of just rolled into two seasons, formed into one. There wasn't really much of a break last time. So it was great to be with them and just have a bit of fun, despite not getting to join in on absolutely everything. But hey, alcohol isn't everything, I can assure you that.
Gotcha. So, you know, now I'm sure it's not only me, but I know there are others who have noticed how fashionable you are. But another cool element about you is your tattoos. And I want to hear your stories behind those and which one's your favorite. And, you know, I learned yesterday that the arm tattoo isn't the only one you have.
Yeah, sure. So the arm tattoo is one of nine. Look at me on a squash court. You wouldn't be able to see all nine. They're hidden. And the one on my arm is probably the most obvious one, with it being on my arm, and it's also by far the biggest. It's kind of like a set of two roses, rose bushes. There's a bit of foliage going on in there amongst the actual rose flowers themselves. And in between the two is like a band of negative space. Honestly, it symbolizes absolutely nothing other than I thought it was cool. But the roses themselves are, I mean, they're definitely my favorite flower. And the town that I'm from in Scotland is called Montrose. So the end of that word is rose. The kind of emblem for the town is a rose, and that's kind of where my affiliation with it comes. Also, I support Leeds United. Leeds is in a county called Yorkshire, and the Yorkshire rose is also their emblem. So to me, gotcha. There's a big connection with roses. And I just thought, I saw this design in a different flower and in a different format on somebody else with the negative space in here. And I thought, you know what? That looks different. I quite like it. And I don't know how it's going to look when I'm 70. I haven't thought about that. But for just now, we're going to just try and rock it as long as we can.
Yeah. That's the thing with tattoos, isn't it? You don't really think of how it's going to look when you're that old.
That's also why I love them, though, because you just go with it. Just go with what feels good in the moment. And you hear all these horror stories of people going, oh, I got this one tattoo when I was A, with this partner, or B, drunk, and now I regret it, and I need to get it covered up, or I need to get it removed. And I will never do that. I will, hand on my heart, never get any tattoo removed or covered up, despite maybe thinking that might not be the best idea, but every it's kind of a piece of art to me, and there's a story behind it, and it signifies a period of your life in that moment, which holds a lot of emotion at the time. So yeah, 9, and probably not going to get any more, but might.
Oh,
not okay. Going to totally rule that out.
We'll see. We'll see. Well, yeah. So I'm aware that you were called for being asked to commentate 2 years back in 2020. And I remember hearing in a podcast that you said you weren't quite sure why they had specifically asked you to do the gig at the time. And now 2 years later, have you really figured, have they given you any hints as to why they had asked you? Or is that still a mystery?
No, that's still a mystery. It's a question I never thought of asking. I've never thought of asking them. But it kind of came out of the blue. We were post COVID, not through anywhere near the worst of it, but we were getting back on tour. We'd had a significant period of time out where the men were going to Qatar, because it's in Qatar politically. We won't get into why the women are not going, but there was no women's event. So I got asked to go at the time, you know, looking to make up some of the financial losses that we'd missed over the course of the months. And the opportunity petrified me. It was something that was completely out of my realm. My whole anxiety was shot through the roof, and was thinking, how on earth am I going to speak into a microphone in front of thousands of people, but also how am I going to even know what to say? You know, we get, like, as squash fans, squash players, you know, professional, amateur, whatever, recreational, you can easily watch squash, but you never think, how would I interpret this? Which words would I use? Or am I even knowledgeable enough to speak about it? You know, because yes, I'm a professional player on the world tour, but what gives me the right to be able to speak about it? So I was thinking, I can't do this. Certainly not to fly all the way to Qatar, have them put me up, pay my flights, and then to completely flunk. That would be mortifying. So I sat with it for a day or so and thought, and didn't sleep. And the whole idea of the petrifiedness and it being totally out of my comfort zone was the kick that I needed to go and do that. Go and take that on. And if you're terrible, nothing lost. You'll just not get asked back. So that's fine. why it was me, I have no idea. Maybe because I think perhaps they needed another female and they wanted one perhaps with an accent. That was all I could think at the time. Female, tick, accent, tick. Any good? Question mark. that was in 2020. And I've been asked back a couple of times. So,
I mean, that's a little bit of an understatement. I think you're a go-to household name on the commentating booth now. I think a lot of people associate you. I do ask a lot of other players on the pod as well about what their thoughts on commentating, and they think that the addition of you is a huge plus and benefit. But is this a long-time gig for you, or are you still uncertain about how you feel about commentating?
I'm definitely not uncertain about how I feel about it. I really enjoy it. Whenever I get asked about it, I instantly feel excited and alive. And I think that that's a really good sign that you do enjoy something and you're passionate about it. The biggest thing for me is, aside from squash, not that I am anywhere near considering retiring, but when I think of what drives me, what are my passions, my hobbies, the things that, like, really give me that buzz and really boost me up, other than squash, and there there honestly are not that many things. Obviously, there's things I like and things I like doing and things, but that gives you that kind of adrenaline rush, that excitement, that I don't know, that ooze of just like my palms are almost sweating right now thinking about it.
Right.
Commentating does that for me. And I think the thing, aside from the stress and the anxiety that it brings and having to deliver and perform, I guess, and do a good job, I completely understand what those two players on the court are going through. Whether one's two love up, two love down, it's two all. Mm. Someone's carrying an injury. Someone's got needs a blood break. Someone's having a head off. Someone looks like they've gone into their shell. I can completely relate and then feel in that moment what they're going through. Obviously, I don't know what's going on in their head, but I can kind of guess. And going by little signals on the court, whether they're doing with their body language or little tactics that they've got going on, I go through it with them. So yeah, I'm feeling absolutely everything these players are feeling. And I think that's why I absolutely love it, because I have a direct association with what's going on the court. The difficult thing is then when it is becoming really tense and really quite fiery is being able to control my own emotions, because I still need to deliver a semi-educated summary of what's going on. But no, it's absolutely great. And would I like to continue to do it? Yes. Is it something that I've particularly thought a lot about after my career? No, just because I'm nowhere near finishing. Mm-hmm. But I would absolutely love to take on any opportunity that I get with it. And also any other media opportunity, because it's something that I've really shied away from in the past. And I need to be more vulnerable with that. So, right. Yeah.
There's one thing I just thought of it that really has always made me curious about commentating is, do you feel like you have a hard time dealing with being biased towards certain players? Is that a thing for you or not really?
Every commentator will have a preferred outcome. I guarantee it. Like, even if they're saying, oh, I don't really care on this one, who wins this one? You kind of do.
Yeah.
You kind of like,
it's hard.
Sometimes, more often than not, it's the underdog, because you like that story. Everyone loves an underdog. With people on the tour that are nicer to me than others, or if there's people who are quite rude to me, then I might not want them to win as much as the others. But honestly, I'm too busy focusing on, have I done my research? Do I know enough about the history between the two players? Have I watched enough of their matches? Do I have enough stats here? And do I know enough about their game recently? So I spend most of the time just trying to think about, have I covered my bases and been able to deliver and give the listeners something that they maybe haven't heard before, or can come away with being like, I never thought about that, or that's a new piece of information, or that was a great insight. So, yeah. I think as well, we love a comeback. So if there's a two love up or a 2-1 situation, like even though it means we sit there for longer, I love a comeback and I just love squash. So unless someone's been particularly awful to me, then I might not want them to win.
And which would you say is the best match you've commentated on this season?
I really loved the Hania and Gohar match in Guna, because it really summed up Hania and her season, if you like, in one match. She was 2 love down in a matter of like 10 minutes. I kid you not. I mean, I don't know the exact time, but it must have been it was like a 7-minute first game. And we were thinking, she's just going to have an edgy start. And then she never settled in. And Gohar, when she's on that roll, she's just flying. And she just can bulldoze everybody out the park. So, and it was the final. And we were thinking, oh, this can't go 3 love in 15 minutes. Because, you know, typically the women's squash is where it's at right now. That the matches are phenomenal. Yeah. Depth is crazy. The quality and the zero shenanigans going on makes it a great spectacle at the minute. You know exactly what I mean.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I do.
The fact that she was completely down and out and was able to then flick that and just dig in. She wasn't playing anywhere near her best, but she just dug in. She just you know, she really was such a fighter. She then was dressed up like a mummy by the end because she had so many bandages wrapped around her. She was bleeding from arms, legs, everywhere. She had a bump on her head. She then had the circle bruise. You know, she had everything. And I think what she was able to do in that moment has set us up for an incredible rivalry between the two of them moving forward into next season. So that to me was a standout match. Again, she'd never beaten Sherbini and Gohar at the same event. And that was really important for her to do that season, was to beat the top two in one event and claim the title. And I think that makes a big statement. And being able to do it in that fashion that she did it, you know, it really pissed Gohar off. She was fuming, which made the World Tour Finals so juicy. Because
did I remember this correctly? That Gohar didn't even come to the trophy presentation for that. Did she exit out?
No, she was there.
Okay.
She was there, and the reason I remember it is because she loves when she's runner up. I hope she's not listening to this. But when she's runner up, she loves to make her speeches go on and on and on. And her speeches outlast the whole ceremony put together, the men's, she just goes on and on and on. And I remember thinking, has she forgotten she lost? Because this sounds like the winner's speech. I guess it's just so well rehearsed at this point, having won so many titles. I remember being there.
That's so odd. I was like, oh my goodness, where is she? But, how about
maybe I've got that wrong. I'm gonna have to go. I'm going on Squash TV.
You should check it out. Yeah.
Anyway, but yeah. So then they played in the World Tour Finals, and it was so feisty. It was fire. It was absolute fire. I was having the time of my life. Like,
yeah.
I couldn't wait for this match. I couldn't wait for them to meet again. Joy had built it up so brilliantly in the pre-match spiel that we do, the opener on the TV.
Yeah.
You know, he really milked the fact that they don't like each other. He milked the fact that they do not have any time or desire to be friends. And then, of course, we did see a really quite feisty affair with a lot of fire. So, again,
Which I'm going to ask you more in depth, actually, in a couple minutes, because I had a series of things lined up for this. But I actually, one more follow-up to the commentating gig was, is there a certain player that you like commentating for, and one player that gives you a little bit of anxiety or nervousness before entering in?
I get, for example, Yusuf Ibrahim. I absolutely love commentating on him for all that skill and that quirkiness that he possesses. And he's always a bit of an unknown. What Yusuf are we going to get? And if we can get the best one, then we're on for a show.
Yeah.
So that kind of pre-match anticipation, he brings that for me. And he's a left-handed player, and I'm left-handed as well.
That helps.
So I really love...
I'm left-handed as well, so...
Oh, yes, get in.
All lefties out here, yeah.
I remember, actually, he beat Mohamed El-Shabagi in Qatar in 2020 when I commentated at that for the very first time. And then I was privileged to be able to sit down and do an interview with him. So I remember that kind of being like a turn for him. Yes, he was still at college, but he'd gotten that big win against Mohamed. And he played great. It was 3-2 and he was 2-1 down. And the squash that he was playing, I thought, if he can nail this consistently and remain injury free, then he's going to be top three, like 100%. He's going to be very difficult to beat. So I'm always excited to watch him. I'm always excited to watch Tarek versus Paul. I love watching Paul play, but more how is Tarek going to be? And in particular, when at the World Championships, he played unbelievably well. He lost, but he played so well. And I love that Tarek. I love he was flawless. There was not many errors. His movement, he never has a bad movement day, but his movement was great. And the quality of squash that they produced was incredible. Ones that make me nervous, I also love watching Sherbini. I mean, who doesn't love watching Sherbini? She's like I could have 25 injuries. Yeah. I could probably chop my hand off and I could take all of my long hair and put it all over my face and I'll still probably win. Like what she can do and what her skill that she possesses with the racket and the short backswing and the subtleties and the hold and the deceptiveness is, it's such a dream to watch. And yeah, I mean, that goes without saying. Ones that make me nervous, potentially ones where you think there might be some traffic issues, you know, where the movement's just not quite as slick and there's maybe a little history there of the movement not being great and you're just thinking, ugh, I hope we don't get that. And then if you get
this could be a disaster, yeah.
Yeah, and then if you get two players where you're like, oh, they're both a little bit like that, then you don't want it to become about the little bits going on. You want it to just be about the squash. So if there's any history of little bits going on, it's a bit like, I hope we don't get that. We just want to see some good squash. I won't name names though, Sean. You're not getting any names out of me.
We'll see about that, Lisa. We got a long podcast ahead of us. Okay, so I want to talk to you, I think, about the state of the game right now. And I thought there wouldn't be a more relevant person to talk to than you about this. And I was going to ask you why you think, especially this season in the latter half, there have been so many controversies and drama that have been on the rise. And, you know, in specific, as mentioned before, I think the Gohar Hammamy beef, it's getting close to getting a little dangerous at this point. And we had the, you know, for example, the Shore Baggy call out against the Rob Owen, Paul Kohlkamp, and even like that match itself with his antics against the refs. I even know where to begin with like Saul. And, you know, I don't know if you saw, but the Diego Twitter call out against Farag, you know, increased hostility everywhere. And if you don't mind, I'd like to go over a couple of these and what your take is on this. And if you think it's good and healthy for the sport. But yeah, I know we just spoke about it, but why don't we still start with the Gohar Hammamy beef? Because it was getting, I feel like they need to have a sit down and because it's getting a little dangerous. I mean, even what happened in the World Tour finals. And yeah, what do you think of that?
I definitely don't condone any kind of violence. there was obviously the drilling in the leg. I think on that occasion, I think there needs to be a kind of review of that ruling, if I'm honest.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because I don't want to speak for Gohar, but Hania does, or she was kind of encroaching that space a couple of times. She did keep playing that wide cross court where it hits the side wall and it comes right back. And I did notice that her movement had encroached over a little bit. So the difficulty you've got there is she set Gohar up with quite a lot of space, with quite a lot of front wall to play and attack and potentially hit a winner. If she stops, she runs the risk of getting a let. Now, if in a situation like that and she's completely prevented, it's a stroke, but it's a risk that you take and you leave in the hands of the referee, which is why I think that needs to be looked into more. Because if she stopped, then she just plays a point over again when she's in quite a good position, but we don't want the violence. I didn't really like how she went about that, though. And I think that kind of alludes to, more of a violent approach to hitting that ball. And I don't think we need to see that again. So I'm kind of going around the houses, but I think that rule needs to be reviewed. And I think that there needs to be a less of an aggressive approach. I mean, I know that they want to beat each other. Of course they do. There's a lot of money on the line. There's points on the line.
All right. Well, why don't we go into the Shore Baggy one now? Because, you know, he's caused some ruckus as well this season. I want to go over that World Champs. I want to go both over what you thought of his antics towards the ref and his post-match interview.
So the post-match interview, and I mean, the whole thing, he's seen red, right? He's seen red. And when you see red, there's no going back. I mean, it's completely wrong how he handled it. It was also really disrespectful, I think, to the sport, his opponent, and the referee. Mm-hmm. But like I just said, there's so much emotions on there. The mm-hmm. pressure is so high. And if you see red for a minute, it's so hard to control. The adrenaline is running so, so high. And he's just lashed out. Go back in time, would he do it again? No, not at all. And I think, you know, his formal apology and his interview in Mauritius, you know, he touched on that and he did apologize. And he is a very respectful guy. You know, he won't deliberately want to have any malice about him or intentionally hurt someone or not have respect, because he is very high on that. But, you know, I'm happy to say that what he did in that moment was completely out of line and should never happen again. But I'm sure he would also say the same thing. But when we talk about these things, though, I truly believe they're talking points. And this is where the line comes between wanting to draw attention to the sport and having fans and spectators back home instigating conversation and instigating social media content. But it has to be for the right reasons. It can't be for violence, and it can't be for misconduct, and it can't be for disrespect.
Yeah. What did you think of that article, by the way?
So
the Rob Owen article.
I think if I was Paul and I'd read it, I would for sure have felt pressure and anxiety, and I would have probably had a word and asked that not to happen again. I've also spoke to Rob about it, and he stands by, like, he did that deliberately, and he doesn't see that it affected Paul whatsoever, and I don't think Paul would ever say that it did either, whether he read it or not, or whether he says he did or not. The article again sparked conversation. Squash stories were all over it. They couldn't stop talking about it, and I think we need more of that. I do. I think we need. Again, you might want to talk about this separately, but Diego calling out Farag on Twitter. I think good on him. I think we need more of that. I honestly do. I think the fans of the sport want to hear and see as much content from the players themselves as possible, right? You want to go onto someone's social media platform, see videos of them, pictures of them, see them speaking. And particularly around matches, post-match in particular, you want to really understand and really get to know, how's he feeling? What's he doing? What does he think of that? Putting out a tweet like that, we got all of those answers straight away.
Oh, loved it, yeah.
And again, we're known to be like a really friendly sport. Oh, squash, yeah, great. Everyone's lovely. Everyone's friends on tour. Look, don't get me wrong. We are, and it's a very small community, and we kind of stick together and do it as best as we can. But we can't all be friends, and we can't all be lovey-dovey and then pretend we go on court and we're still lovey-dovey. There are rivalries there, and there is a lot of angst there. And I think the more people can show their personalities and show what they're thinking, again, it comes down to it still must be respectful. And there kind of be no misconduct about it. But let's hear from the players about, especially in vulnerable moments, post-match, perfect vulnerable moment.
Are you guys going to start doing the post-match interviews for the players who have lost?
No, that's a tricky one. Because when you've lost, you don't want to talk to anyone.
Right.
So I don't think that's going to be a favorite amongst the players. But I did like that kind of press conference-y style, bring the player in, let's see them when they're at the highest of their emotions, and let's hear what they have to say with the backdrop of that tournament. I did like that vibe. Was that in Manchester they did that? I can't remember.
I think they did it in one of the US tournaments. I think a year back.
Okay. I think it's a good addition. They do it in tennis, right? And it works. You get a lot of spice.
It works. I mean, people are only tuning into the players who have lost. I think that's where all the traction goes to.
That's
something that I, yeah. I mean, especially with this season, I would have honestly, instead of Diego just saying, you know, that simple tweet, I would have loved to have him fully tackle this question of what he thought about that. And, you know, I think that could have been captured, you know, the high adrenaline.
Yeah.
You know, maybe makes a couple mistakes when he says some stuff. But so I guess you're on board. You think this type of, you know, a little controversy and drama is good for the sport, would you say?
I think so. Yeah. Again, it comes down to there's a line of respect. And you can, if mm-hmm. you can keep on the right side of that line, then speak up. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, Lisa, thank you for, you know, entertaining me on those couple. I know I might've put you in an uncomfortable position there, but I really just wanted to hear your thoughts on those. Cause I think you're there in the behind the scenes, you're commentating on these players. And I thought who better to ask, but kind of transitioning more towards you, Lisa, I know you're no stranger to moving bases for training. And I know one of your most recent major moves has been moving to Egypt. Are you still, is that still in plan, or have you switched now?
So, I kind of do hop around a lot. My home is Edinburgh. So I'm currently here in Edinburgh right now. We're preparing for the Commonwealth Games, and it's important that I'm around the teammates and my doubles partners. And it's also just nice to come home for a little bit. I have a coach in Ipswich, Lauren Selby. So I have worked with her since the beginning of COVID. So initially when we came out of lockdown and we were back playing and things, I spent a lot of time in England, Ipswich, southeast. And not about a year ago, I decided to start working with Ahmed Efa in Cairo. Now, Cairo, if I have one regret, it's not going sooner. It's always something I've wanted to do, immerse myself into their culture, their training environment, and see what it's all about. I mean, they have so many great players. They also have a lot of great coaches. And I just wanted to, I've always been like jealous, but like jealous and curious and wanted to do it, but never really brought that to reality until I'm a little bit older and I'm just really wanting to leave no stone unturned. So I started chatting with Kika, and yeah, I absolutely love it there. So much so that after the Commonwealth Games, I'm looking to get an apartment and base myself there in between events as a kind of more permanent fixture. For me, it's the best choice in terms of the things that I'm looking to implement into my game and the changes that I'm looking to make within my game that I feel will take me up the rankings, is that attacking style of squash and utilizing the front of the court a lot more. And so where better to go than Egypt?
Yeah. You've been training in Egypt for the past year, would you say? Is that, or has it been 2 years now?
No, just 1 year really, but it's only been like a week here or there or 2 weeks here or there. It's never really been for like a consistent block.
Okay. I don't know if you have the answer to this, but have you noticed something vastly different or something very unique with the way Egyptians go about their training? Have you, that you've picked up on?
One thing that stands out is they do 3 sessions a day. And I don't know if everyone in the States does that, but certainly in the training environments I've experienced before and training partners that I've put myself around, 3 sessions a day is a lot. So I was curious to know, like, how can they do that for the whole week? Well, they don't do it all week. They do it maybe 4 days a week. They have 3 sessions, but it's structured very similar to everyone's. They get up and they have fitness in the morning. Fitness could be anything from activation, mobility, strength and conditioning, endurance, speed, anything that's gym based and working on the body. And then from there, you typically go and you have a session with your coach on court. So you're grooving the technique, working on the movement specific stuff or any kind of squash stuff you're working on. And then later at night, you'll play a match. So that was a tough adjustment for me. Like, 32 years old, right. 3 sessions a day, a lot. So that would be the biggest thing. And also, they like to play later in the, at night. And I've told you before, I'm usually in bed by 9 o'clock. I'm an early riser and early to go to bed. And yeah. That was an adjustment as well. But, you know, a few days and you're fine.
Yeah. That is interesting. I mean, I've always been curious about, you do see a shift right now in squash. I think with a lot of players, I think either are creating hubs of training, and there are always some players who are opting to have like their individual camps. Do you think there is a right formula to it for you? Do you think?
I think each period of time in your career, there's going to be different formulas for what you need. So perhaps the Egyptian way wouldn't have suited me when I was 20 to 23. I don't know. It's hard to tell. But I think one thing I've always been quite good at doing is assessing what I do need in that moment and going out and trying to make it happen. And predominantly that's away from home. And certainly right now, I think that Egypt has everything that, I mean, to be honest with you, like, it's also about who you want to surround yourself with as well. And that is a large part of it. So being around the right people, the people who are lifting you up every day, encouraging you, motivating you, inspiring you every single day. If you're not surrounding yourself with those types of people and people who are much better in terms of ranking and things, if you're not surrounding yourself with that environment, it is going to be a lot harder to gain success. It's not impossible, but it's a lot harder. So I truly believe that really dialing into what you need from your environment, the people around you, where you live, the culture, everything that environment has to offer, it pays off because you have to be happy and you have to be in a good mindset.
I don't want to harp on this too much, but I know there was an illness that took you out for a couple of years. I think you might have told this story way too many times, and I think you can also check it out on the In Squash podcast episode that you've done, and it's an absolute brilliant one. But the question I had for you was what made you continue playing? Because there's so many players you see that, you know, kind of dip out mid-career because there's just such a lack of money in the sport. And what would you say was the determinant factor for you to continue pushing to get back into the sport?
Well, certainly wasn't money. I would say it really just to me felt like two things. One, I'd been given like a second life, a second chance. When I was really super sick, I didn't think there was going to be a version of me that played sport after. You know, at that point, I was thinking, I'm maybe not even going to be able to go run again, let alone play recreational sport. So the fact that I was able to overcome it and I felt like I'd been given a second life. And also it was kind of just like unfinished business. There was a lot of unfinished business there. Big goals and I believe a lot in my potential. And that would have been a big regret had I not tried to explore that and challenge myself within that to see what could happen. So those two things, but really it was just like always niggling away at me every day being like, you've got to find a way to get back because you've so much left to do.
Mm-hmm. And I guess I should have asked this from the very start of this interview, but how do you feel about your squash at this very moment?
Pretty good. Exciting because I feel like the changes that I've made recently with the whole Cairo thing, being really comfortable in my personal life and really content with the coaches that I'm working with and what we're working on and how they have an understanding of me as a player and how I want to express myself when I'm on court. Really excites me that I have people that are on board with that. And I think there's been glimpses of it this season where it's been very close to a really good win, or very close to being the standard that's required to be kind of top 20 and beyond. There's been glimpses of it. And I think that's what encourages me to keep pushing on and try and find some consistency with that, whether it's remaining healthy, remaining injury free, and being able to kind of get a good season under my belt.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm sure this counts as this season. I think it was your match against Hania that went to 5. I think it was last year, actually.
Yeah.
Would you say that was one of your best matches of the season? Because that was absolutely brilliant, just from the very start. Would you pick that as your best match of the season or no?
As an overall performance, in terms of what I would call complete squash, I would say no.
Okay.
I've watched that back so many times, and for sure it was great to go to 5 sets with Hania and really test myself for 75 minutes against one of the best players in the world. But watching it back, there was a lot missing. I predominantly just played to the back 2 corners. And if I'm choosing to only play to half the court, there's no way I was ever going to win that match. And there's certainly no way I'm ever going to beat a top 10 player just by using those 2 corners. So it kind of gave me a lot of encouragement in the sense that I did get so close with a lot of guts, quite good fitness levels, and quite good length quality. Mm-hmm. But now how can we get the rest of it? How can we work on the attacking side so that instead of losing 3-2, you're maybe winning, you're turning those losses into a win? And I think...
Right.
So in terms... I was really proud of myself, and it did give me a lot of encouragement in that match. But in terms of complete performance, Egyptian Open, at the Pyramids for me last year, I strung together 3 really good matches. I was pleased with the overall squash that I played there.
So that would be, you would say, your proudest moment of this past season.
Yeah.
And moving on to your goals now, is the draw out for it's not out yet?
No, for the Commonwealth Games, it's not out, no.
Do you know where you're going to be seated for it, at least? Or no?
No. To be honest, I guess I could work it out if I counted down what number I would be in all the Commonwealth countries. Women's doubles, we finished 5th at the Worlds, and mixed doubles, we finished 3rd. So I'm hoping a top 5 seeding for both. But yeah, I mean, I don't know when you're going to release this podcast, but as it stands, I have a broken hand. My left hand is broken.
Oh, right, yeah.
I'm just hoping that it's kind of stitches itself back together and I'm going to be okay. So whilst I'm really thinking positive thoughts and that I'll be able to play, the draws is certainly like not in my head right now. It's how can we get to hold the racket and be
healthy
with a broken hand.
Okay. Well, okay. Lisa, I'm going to move on to the quick fire segment. I don't know if you know this segment, but it's just, I'm going to ask you a bunch of questions, just get your thoughts on it, and a couple of them are really juicy. Hopefully you drop some names, but just to get to know you a little better.
Cool.
But let's start with, who do you think is the best dressed player on tour, excluding you?
Ooh. Can I say PJ?
Oh, that's a cop out. I need an actual actor.
Okay,
player.
Okay. You know, this is actually a really tough question. I'm going to go for... Can I pick a duo? A duo? I think they would like to be classed as a wee duo. Nada Abbas and Rowan El Arabi have quite a little quirky fashion style going on between the two of them. And they're close friends and kind of like young and down with it. So I'm going to pick them.
Got the trends.
Yeah.
All down. Yeah. Okay, now I have to ask, who needs work on their fashion or how they dress? And even if you refuse to answer this, there were so many questions that came in on your Instagram asking who needs work. So this was not my question, actually.
Can we come back to this one?
Yeah, and I can also help you out with my thoughts.
Okay, go. Let's hear your thoughts.
Okay, so I think I think Farag needs a little work.
I was going to say, So sometimes he does the navy and the black thing, which I'm not keen with. And sometimes the polo shirts with the button up to the top, I'm not feeling. So I was going to say that, but then I thought, I don't know. But I would, go on. Who else have you got on that list?
I think he was there. I put Kandra up there. Also, I know Rosner's retired, but Rosner would have been 100% on top of that list for me. And also, Mohammed El-Shabaghi kind of sometimes has some questionable baggy stuff going on.
I think he can do better with the shorts.
Yeah.
The white oversized shorts. I think he you know, show off those legs. I think he can do better with those shorts.
You gotta show them off.
Do you have any women on the list?
That I couldn't bucket with that. Do you have anyone in mind?
Yeah, I'm gonna call her right out, and I'm gonna say SJ. 100%.
It's the shooting sleeve doesn't do it for you.
It's the sleeve. I mean, the sleeve is there for like probably just psychological benefits at this point, but it's the socks.
Mm-hmm.
It's the socks for me. But I will say one thing I do appreciate is if she's ever unsure, she's started to ask, "Is this okay? What do you think of this?" So it's a work in progress.
It is a work in progress. Well, you know, I'm glad we mentioned some names there, and hopefully they tune in and step it up for next season. But okay, thoughts. What are your thoughts on the best of three?
I like it, but I don't want it to be a thing for implemented in the tour. I think best of five squash is all about the best of five. So one-off events, quirky little things like that, I'm happy with, but that's probably about it.
Okay. So you like the way it is right now?
I like the way it is right now. Just going back to the previous question, though, Tayeb's shirts, she can do better with those too.
Oh my God. How could I forget?
She's got an amazing figure. And
yeah,
it looks like she's wearing Ali's polo shirt sometimes. So I'm just saying, I know that she's capable of better than that, but perhaps it's like it's what she did, you know, it's what she's always done. Perhaps it's a comfort thing or superstitious thing. Totally get that.
Mm-hmm.
But I've seen what she wears off the court. She's better than that.
She's better. Again, we are not shitting on players. We are simply, you know, putting some words of encouragement for,
I mean, look at this just, shirt. You know,
their potential.
Look at this shirt, for
their
example.
Potential.
Like, who am I? Who am I to even say?
I don't know, Lisa. I think you do have quite a reputation right now as best dressed. But I think this is a really good question for you. So are you a big fan of the softball doubles?
Yes. Yeah. Massive fan. And would love there to be somewhat a tour in some capacity that didn't take away from the singles, obviously, but if it could somehow be implemented or attached to certain big events, almost like a series of eight across the year, and there'd be an actual ranking system, I would love that.
And I mean, because you're quite well versed with doubles, who would be your ideal partner for both men and women for mixed and
current players only?
Current players only.
Okay. Male. Do you know, my partner, Greg Lobban, is actually quite good, you know. Right before the Commonwealth Games, I'm not sure if I can pick somebody else, but I'll pick somebody. Okay, let's go for either Mazen Hesham, because who knows what he's going to hit, when he's going to hit it.
Never know, yeah.
Mohammed would be quite good. He'd be ruthless and absolutely no prisoners, and I think he'd slot a few. But in terms of like, just let's have some fun, I would say Mazen or even Dazuki.
I think Dazuki's name has been mentioned a couple times for this question.
Women's, I would pick Gohar, because I think everyone would be so scared they would just stand miles away from her, and she would have lots of court to play. I'm not sure how much I would enjoy. I think I would also be scared, but that could be quite interesting So in terms of fun, I'm going to have to pick a right-handed player. I'm going to go... I'll go Tayyip. Neural Tayyip.
Yeah. Super pretty good pick. Who's one player you would like to see, or anyone in the squash community you'd like to see on that commentator's booth?
Sean Conroy.
Okay.
I think he's got a good personality. I think he's a funny guy. Yeah. I actually haven't spent too much time with him, but from what I can see and what I've heard, I think he'd be quite good crack on the commentating. Or I'm not doing too well with these questions.
No, it's totally fine. Just trying to choose out every single name out of you.
Who would you like?
Who would I like on that commentator's booth? I've actually talked to him about it, but I don't know if he does want to do it. I think Patrick Rooney would be hilarious.
Oh yes, no, that's a great pick. Yeah, no, that would be fun. Yeah, Patrick, definitely.
I think he would. I think he would bring the lighthearted atmosphere.
Yeah, 100%.
Drop some jokes in. Really should get him in that booth, even though I think he might refuse to. But how about? What are your thoughts on the U.S. college squash scene?
Regret not going.
Really? Yeah.
So I kind of, when I was at that age of leaving school and considering college, the vibe was very much still, well, you either are going to be a professional squash player or you're going to pick academics and go to uni. So I didn't study at that point. That was very much the viewpoint of all coaches. Most coaches or anyone that I spoke to, it was a consideration. There definitely was a couple of options that were interested. And I was pretty much told, mainly by who was running Scottish squash at the time, the national coach, was that, well, if I picked that, it showed I wasn't interested that much in becoming a good player. So, I mean, you can imagine how that felt and therefore why I chose squash. But do I regret doing that? I do. And I think seeing all the success and all the great players that have come out of the system was the main reason I chose to start studying 3 years ago. So I'm at university now, and they showed me it was possible. And of course it is. I mean, there's so many lessons to be learned in doing both at the same time. But yeah, I mean, I would encourage absolutely anyone who gets the chance to go to college and experience their squash in their early 20s. It bridges that gap nicely between juniors and seniors. It teaches you to be mature and kind of be independent all at the same time. And you really find a lot out about yourself in those years. So it gives you the freedom to also, whilst not, you are obviously part of a team and have a coach, but you're kind of free to explore your own identity within your squash as well without being dictated to too much. And I think that's so important that you're able to keep the flair, the personality, all these quirks that you have that have made you great so far, and really explore them and enhance them without becoming too robotic or going down any other systems where it changes you a little bit. So yeah, I am all on board with that. I wouldn't even rule out being part of college squash sometimes. So
that would be fun. And have you considered coaching post-career? Is that an option?
It could be an option. I think if the right coaching job came up, 100%, I would love to kind of share everything, mainly all the experiences and lessons that I learned along the way and help others in certain aspects with that. It's never been something that I thought I would do as a job, but again, wouldn't rule it out if the right opportunity came. I definitely would be interested, but I guess it's hard as well for me thinking of going on court right now to coach when I spend so many hours on court trying to improve me. At the minute, the last thing I want to go on court and do is try and improve someone else. So maybe that mindset would switch, you know, when I've retired and it's no longer all about me. Because I do love it. You know, I've done the camps and I've done like clinics and days of coaching, and I get such a buzz from it. Right. So I wouldn't rule it out, but yeah, it would have to be the right job.
I mean, I could totally see you as a college squash coach as well. leading the team to national victories. But okay, I have two more juicy ones before I move on to the life related questions. But who do you think is the most underrated player on tour right now?
Underrated. Ooh. I think everyone who, I was going to say Victor, but then again, like, Victor has not been underrated whatsoever. He's done phenomenal. And
yeah, he's been getting the traction. Yeah.
Yeah. And he beat Paul.
And he has moved up the ranking.
And he has moved up. Yeah. But just quietly goes about his business. You know what I mean? Like, he's unassuming and he's no drama and he just cracks on and gets it done. And Kandra's a little bit like that as well. Yeah. And then he kind of comes and ebbs and flows with his consistency and his form. But I mean, yeah, one, I think Patrick's just going to keep getting better and better. Again, he's already up at 20. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Lucy Turmel as well. I think she did get up to 20. She did get to 20. Now she's at 28, but I think don't underestimate that drop off. I think she's a great player and is doing a good job in exploring all of her potential. So those two, I guess. That feels wrong to pick two English up-and-coming players being a Scot, but I'll just throw out Georgia Adderley and Rory Stewart in there as well, because they're definitely got so much talent, and Georgia's hot on my ass and Rory's already like flying high. So
I had Stuart Crawford on. I don't know if you know.
Yeah.
I've had him on a couple of times, and I think he's mentioned Rory.
Yeah, no. About, yeah, no.
Get he's on a, well he's a player Stuart. To watch out for.
Yeah, definitely. If he can knuckle down and get the attention into the right areas and get the right mindset,
it's exactly what Stuart said.
But he's so much potential. I don't know if you've ever watched him, but I mean, I have some clips. So he does this backhand topspin. It sends everybody the wrong way, and I just love it when he plays it. So whenever he does play it in tournaments, he goes back, he clips it, and he sends it to me. So I've just a bank in my phone of Rory Stewart's top backhand top spins, which I can happily forward on. I think a changing environment would help him a little bit, maybe exploring, going out of his comfort zone and putting himself into another training environment around different guys would help him. And I hope he does that, because he's a lot of talent.
Yeah. And who do you think are the most overrated players on tour right now?
Love these questions. I'm not going to give you a female, because I'm just not going to do that. I'm still playing and I don't want to do that.
You know what? That's fair. We'll exclude the,
That's tough to pick. That's tough. I don't know. I'm not sure I can give you an answer for that.
Damn it. I was really hoping you had an answer in mind.
No, I don't think I have a name for overrated. Well, who do you think?
Oh, no. No one's redirected the question at me for this. So this is new.
I maybe could have, if you'd sent me these questions before, I could have scanned the list.
Oh, now I'm regretting it. I actually do have a name. I think this is an odd one. I don't know if people might be up my ass about this, but I think Mazen Hisham is overrated.
Okay.
I just, the reason why I say that is I just don't think he has the potential to crack above where he's at right now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he has any chance of breaking into that top mold. And I have like other players in near his ranking area that I do think have that potential, but I do think he has kind of hit his potential. Again, that's my opinion. People could, you know, outrageously disagree with me on that.
No, I know what you mean. I think the big question is, can he stay injury free? And can he stay injury free for the whole season? And I know that this summer, that's something he's going to really try and put. He's going to put himself in a different country under care where he can really try and knuckle down on these injuries. I think his injuries play a massive effect on his mindset, his mentality when he's on court. So we see him go up and down all the time. But for example, like in Houston, when he played the Mazen there and he's got that form, he's very dangerous. But like you said, like being able to do that consistently over a season is hard. But then again, it's also hard to get eight in the world, and he's eight in the world.
Yeah, that is fair. Yeah. I'm going to move on to some life-related ones. Lisa, if you're shipwrecked on an island and all your basics are covered, what are the two things you bring with you?
All my basics are covered. I'm going to say I'm going to bring a never-ending bottle of whiskey. Because there's such things.
That's...
And... maybe just a cat.
Oh, are you a big cat person?
No, but I think I could be if I was stuck on the desert.
That's a very answer I did not expect.
Well, I can talk to someone and not have them talk back, and I find that ideal.
That's quite the unique companionship you're seeking for. Because cats wouldn't be the top. But okay, that's okay. How about best and worst purchase you've ever made?
Worst purchase I ever made was when living in Scotland, I bought a bright orange convertible Mini. I mean, it's two things wrong. Bright orange Mini, what are you thinking? Two convertible living in Scotland. You don't need that. That was by far my worst purchase. Best purchase. Ooh. Probably my whip, honestly. Like my whip band. Yeah. Probably the investment that I make in that has taught me a lot about myself, and taught me a lot how to train smart. So I think for all round, like most benefit of any purchase, this has given me a lot.
Have you seeked, are you sponsored by Whoop?
No.
Whoop? Have you seeked out a
No.
Do you think they would give you?
Probably not. I need to be a little bit more famous, do you not think?
I mean, I think with the founder of Whoop being, having such a strong squash background,
maybe, might be worth a shout.
Yeah. But okay. So next question is biggest pet peeve for you. Or pet peeves?
Well, loud eating. Like that's a no-no. Yeah. People leaving the toilet seat up. No.
So that's all men out there who are listening.
Wasn't going to be specific, but you make your own mind up. People parking like just a little bit, not in the space. Don't drive if you can't park. Yeah. People parking in disabled bays, don't do that. Like if you don't need, if you've not got a disabled badge, don't do that. Bad manners, just like simple respect and bad manners.
Okay.
Mm.
Just be a decent human being.
Just be nice.
And so one last question I had actually was, do you own a coffee business? What's going on with the coffee thing?
I just love coffee. I'd love to own a coffee business. That would be great.
It's a
coffee sponsor. So there's a company here in Edinburgh. Shout out to them. Modern Standard Coffee. And they provide me with free coffee. I mean, what more can you ask for? And it's great coffee. They just post it through my letterbox every week. It's great. So I mean, I've 5 bags staring me in the face right over there. And I don't know how I'm going to get through them by the time the next bag comes. But yeah, they're awesome.
Oh, that's phenomenal. Okay. So to wrap it up, I'm going to do a couple Instagram questions. It's going to be tough because everyone asked about just like who's the best dressed, who's the worst dressed. But
I've got the rankings up in front of me now. We can go through all these again. Now I've got the names.
Gilly Lane actually asked, what do you love most about being an MC?
An MC? I love nothing about being an MC. So let me tell you that story. In Guna, I had to do the MCing, which...
yeah.
Is, I can tell you now, there's a big difference between speaking in a microphone to a TV screen and speaking in a microphone to a crowd that have eyes looking at you. So that was a mistake, really. Somehow they'd cancelled the MC, the very tall and beautiful Lebanese MC that did arrive for the semifinals, was supposed to be there all week or something like that. Anyway, it turns out that she wasn't coming until the semis, and could they steal one of the commentators to come and do the emceeing, which of course, short straw, was me. And I can assure you that I was in the whoop red all week, suffered very high anxiety levels, and experienced it enough to not want to do that again. I was so chuffed when I got to go back into the commentating booth and hide away behind the screen. That was much, much more my scene. But no, I don't know. Gilly is phenomenal MC. I don't know how he does it. Big respect. Mm-hmm. It's very difficult.
Yeah, no, it's a tough gig. It's a tough gig. Someone else asked, this is a weird question, but someone asked what her favorite species of goat is. Is there a backstory behind
it? Do you know the name that I could tell you? Does it begin with P?
Yeah. It does.
Pass, next question.
what is some other good ones that I guess this is a classic, and I'll wrap it up after this one. What made you want to go into squash as a career?
I guess just a combination of a little bit of success as a junior in Scotland and then in Europe. I was number one in Scotland, number one in Europe up until under 17s. And I kind of wanted to know, to seek a further challenge and to just try and take on the world and see how I fared up against everybody else. But really, honestly, like, I did so much sports as a kid. Like, I love sport. I still love sport. I try and play as much of it as I can when I can. And squash was the only one that was like a standout favorite. It was like I could run as fast as I could in this box with someone else right there smacking this ball about as hard as I could. And as a kid, that was just phenomenal. It was such an adrenaline rush. And then as you got older and a little bit better, then the mental side came in and having to actually work out where you're hitting the space. And so the physicality with the kind of mental chess. But ultimately it comes down to, I wanted to test myself. I wanted to see how I would fare up against everybody else in the world. And also if I tried really, really hard at it and gave it everything, where was I going to come? Where was I going to end up? And I think that challenge alone, I'm kind of like that with most things, I would say.
Yeah. I mean, top 29 in the world is not too shabby.
It's not good enough though, Sean. It's not good enough.
So yeah, I'm just going to wrap it up there. Before I do wrap it up though, I do want to just call out your doubles partner actually voted for you that worst stress player on tour as a statement. Just throwing it out there.
Greg or Georgia?
Greg did.
Noted. Noted. But, coming from a guy with a mustache and a mullet that drinks chai lattes, I mean, come on. Enough said.
Oh my god, that's a great comeback for it. But yeah, thank you, Lisa, for joining in on this. It was a great conversation. But appreciate
thank
you coming
you for
by.
Having me. It's been a great time. We should do this again.